Welcome to the wild side. This is your host, Caitlin Kight, and that was Moro Picotto with Lizard. And I have chosen that song to start us off today because I want to talk about feral cats and anti-predator behaviors in the Mediterranean islands. And this is one of two recent papers that I want to discuss today. The other one has nothing to do with that except that it does look at birds that also are often found by the ocean and in island-type habitats. So basically, I've just chosen two recent science papers that I thought were pretty interesting, and I'm going to discuss them today. So to give you a bit of introduction to the lizard paper, this is a paper that looks at the effects of exotic species introductions on behaviors of animals that are native to the places in which the exotic species have been introduced. So in this case, they're thinking about cats that have been introduced to islands where there are lizards that are living, some of them near people and therefore near cats where the cats are dwelling, and also quite far away from people. And so they're interested in thinking about whether the pressures placed on these cats by their predatory behaviors are received differently depending on whether the lizards are close to or near, close or far from the cats themselves, and whether actually just over the past few years and the past several hundred years, depending on which island we're talking about, the lizards might have begun to adapt to the presence of the animals that have been introduced, in particular the cats, and have actually begun to evolve in response to that. So to give you a bit of context here, island species are particularly at risk of extinction. So over 30% of all the world's species are potentially going to go extinct, and island species are quite a large proportion of all of those 30%. And that's because, in large part, exotic predators are especially problematic, because often islands don't have any natural predators of this type, or they have very few of them, and so the animals that dwell there aren't adapted to respond appropriately. For example, the gray ox that went extinct, I think in the 1800s, the reason that they disappeared was because they had absolutely no idea that things like humans could actually be dangerous. And so they just sat there as the humans approached them and let people club them to death, throw them in bags, take them off and eat them. And they didn't even think to respond in some way, to take flight. Actually, they couldn't fly, but to run away, to jump into the ocean, to try to do something to help themselves. And so inhabitants of islands are often going to be quite at risk of these exotic species. And this is particularly true because anti-predator behaviors can often be quite costly. So they can be time-consuming, they can be energetically costly. And so these are one of the first things that animals are going to lose if they ever did possess them. So in some cases, you might think that these guys would have some sort of instinctual response when they are threatened with a predator, and so they might be able to show that behavior and therefore protect themselves. But living in these islands where they often don't have this sort of experience on a day-to-day basis, they, over time, may have just gotten rid of these behaviors if they ever had them on the mainland, or if they ever at some point in their evolutionary history did have a predator. And so no longer would they have these things around to help themselves. Now, feral cats are one of the most common introduced predators, and I've spoken about these guys on the show in the past and some of the horrible damage that they do. They're thought to have been introduced to some 179,000 islands around the world. And in these places, they're thought to be responsible for about 8.2% of extinctions, which is not negligible when you consider that we're talking about entire species that are just being wiped out. And they're also involved in about 14% of the declines of endangered birds, mammals, and reptiles in these places. So because of this, they're considered to be one of the 100 worst invasive species globally. Now, the reason that cats are such a problem is that they're dietary generalists, so they'll eat just about anything, which means that lots of different animals are going to be at risk. And they're also very efficient predators, and this means, collectively, that they can target a wide range of organisms and take out a large number of them. Now, cats were introduced to the eastern Mediterranean islands about 9,500 years ago or more, and to the Aegean islands during the Bronze Age. So this is an interesting area in which to study the impacts of these animals because it's been such a long history of interactions between cats and the local wildlife. And one of the species, or one of the groups of species, that cats often target in these places is lizards. Now, if you've ever seen lizards in the wild or watched them on television perhaps, you know that lots of them have a tail shedding defense called autotomy, and this helps them avoid capture. So basically, as soon as something grabs onto them, they can just, well, assuming they've grabbed onto the tail, they can drop the tail, leaving the animal only with that kind of useless part of them in its paws, whereas the main body of the lizard can go running off into safety. Some lizards also have tails that continue to kind of move around once they're dropped off, and this means that you could do that at any time, and then the animal would be distracted by that movement and think maybe it's a more interesting item of prey, and then again, they would pay their attention to something else, and you would be able to scuttle off if you were the lizard that had done that. So this can be quite a useful thing to help them avoid capture. And of course, the other thing that they can do is simply run away. So if they see the predator in time before they're encountering it one-on-one, in hand-to-hand combat, so to speak, they can actually just go seek refuge. Now, tails are quite important in lizards for both locomotion, also for courtship, for defense, for lipid storage, for signaling their status. So it's important that they hold on to the tails unless they absolutely have to shed them in certain conditions. So this is why I said earlier that this can be kind of a costly thing for them to engage in these anti-predator behaviors. So basically, you would expect lizards to show tail shedding behaviors only in places where they're going to have the greatest cat predation pressure, or predation from any other animal if you want to be really general. Now the other thing I mentioned, the running away, this is associated with something that I've also discussed in the past on the show called flight initiation distance. So this is the distance between prey and predator at which the prey initiates an escape. And so you would expect that this would increase with both predation risk and increasing distance to refuge. So basically, the more likely you are to encounter a predator in your environment, the more cautious you should be, and therefore the more quickly you should run away anytime something starts to approach you. And also, the more open you are in terms of your habitat, the farther you are from cover, the more likely you are to run away more quickly because you know that you're going to need more time to get to that hiding spot. So lizards in places with few cats or where cats have only recently been introduced should probably have smaller flight initiation distances, or FIDs, because they haven't quite yet gotten used to the idea that cats are dangerous. And this could be influenced by habitat, because if the habitats are also quite closed in, then that can also influence how quickly they take off, because maybe they think they can be a bit more they can throw a bit more caution to the wind if there are places more close by where they can go hide once they do run. So basically, the authors of this paper were interested in looking at the interactions of all of these things. The presence of cats, the type of habitat, the proximity to villages where people live, the number of lizards, and also the lizard behavior. So kind of collecting information on all of these variables in order to piece together a picture that describes whether or not the lizards are adapting to the presence of cats and whether the presence of cats is associated with human activities. So these two factors were, these two main factors, the FID and the lizard tail shedding behaviors, were investigated in two different types of habitats in the Mediterranean basin. And this area was chosen because it's a biodiversity hotspot that has more than 460 types of reptiles and amphibians alone, not just thinking about all the other species as well. And many of these species are also endangered or extinct, and they have suffered from the presence of exotic predators. So understanding what's happening in this area, which does have thousands of years of experience with human activities and various sorts of introductions, can be really important because it actually does have direct conservation value. Now, the authors looked at sites that had heavy predation pressure, so where there were lots of cats near villages, and also at sites with less predation pressure, where there are fewer cats that are farther from settlements. And they did this both on one island and also between one island and a bunch of little islets that were just off the coast. And one of those islets, in fact, had only very recently been broken off from the mainland, basically. So they've got different stages of isolation. And this is how they were interested in investigating the effects of cat predation on these current population. So let's think about the materials and methods that these guys used in order to do this research. The study was conducted at 18 sites on the island of Naxos, which is in the Aegean Sea in Greece, and also four satellite islands, I would pronounce these names for you incorrectly, so I'm not even going to tell you what they are, but I will tell you that the last of them is called Mondo, and Mondo was separated from the main island by a storm in 2006. So it's the one that's most recently been isolated. And then the other three were separated about 5,600 to 6,000 years ago. So these lizards have lived in pretty much isolation for quite a long time. And Naxos itself has been separated from Europe since the Middle Pleistocene. So all of these areas have different historical regimes in terms of how far away they are from human settlements, and then also how long it took for humans to settle them, and to then have cats along with them that could potentially interact with the lizards. So you've got a variety of stuff going on there. Now, within the 18 sites on Naxos, they had 9 that were within 300 meters of villages, and they assumed and then tested whether these would be high cat density areas. And then they had 9 that were over 500 meters from the villages, and again, they assumed and then tested whether these were areas that had low cat densities. Now, the species of lizard that they focused on was the Aegean wall lizard, and this is a common species that's quite small. It's terrestrial, obviously, because it's on the island. It's insectivorous, and it inhabits dry stone walls, and therefore is quite common in anthropogenic areas, because, of course, that could mean houses, it could mean walls outside in your garden, it could mean the wall in between a couple of different agricultural fields. There are lots of places where these things are found. And also there are kind of naturalish walls as well, whether it's just piles of rock or places that are quite far from human settlements where these lizards can inhabit. Now, this is also a place where cats have frequently been observed hunting the lizards and have been seen walking around with dead lizards in their mouths, so the researchers knew that this was a place where there was going to be predatory activity. The first thing they did was provide a population estimation for the cats. So they measured the density of the cats along 1 kilometer road transects by moving at about 4 kilometers per hour and searching within 50 meters of the roadside. And they did all of this during kind of peak cat activity hours, which were 9 p.m. to 12:30 a.m. And they repeated these surveys 3 different times so they could get a really good estimate of about how many cats were found in each of these areas. They did a similar thing for the lizards, except that it was kind of on a different scale. So they picked 100 meter wall sections at each of the sites, and they walked along the wall and counted the number of lizards that they could be seen on, that they could see on the wall or on the nearby ground. And again, they repeated these surveys 3 times so they could get a nice average that reflected what was actually going on there. While they were doing all this, they also took note of the habitat features, because as I said earlier, the kind of how closed in or not the habitat is can really affect how quickly the lizards want to flee whenever something approaches them. So they looked at things like canopy cover, how much vegetation there was, how many arthropods there were, the wall height, the wall direction, basically anything that they could think of that might impact the behavior of the lizards and the exposure potentially to the cats. Now the really interesting part of the paper is their measurements of lizard anti-predator behavior. Now they studied at least 30 focal lizards per site, and they performed both observations and experiments later on in the lab. So for the observations, they went out 2 different times a day, one in the morning and one in the evening, and they spotted a lizard, and then they began to approach it at a standard speed, so about 45 meters per minute was their pace. And they measured the distance at which the lizards initiated their escape. They also looked at how long the lizards had to run before they got to a refuge, and they looked at whether the lizards were male or female, because sometimes the different sexes will respond quite differently when they are approached by some type of animal, whether it's a predator or not. They also, as I said, performed observations within a laboratory setting. So they went to each of the sites where they were studying the lizards, and then they collected 10 males and 10 females. And they did this at 3 of the high cat density places and 3 of the low cat density places. So basically, they're selecting animals from each end of the spectrum, so the ones that you would expect to respond the most and also to the least to the cats. And they also grabbed a bunch of samples from the islets as well. Now, they only grabbed individuals that had fully intact tails because they wanted to make sure that these guys hadn't had some sort of a previous experience that could impact how they acted in the lab. And this is not just experience with the cat, but also just purely shedding one's tail can impact whether or not it's going to be shed again in the future or how quickly that happens. So they only wanted individuals that had likely not gone through one of these events before. They let the lizards acclimate to the laboratory for a while, and then they exposed them to two different types of experiment. So first of all, they did a tail-shedding investigation, where they measured how easy it was for the animals to undergo autotomy, or getting rid of their tail. So they grabbed the base of the tail, about 20 millimeters from where it was attached to the body. They depressed the tail to half its thickness for about 20 seconds, which would mimic, you know, maybe a predator slapping down a paw and holding it in place. And then they measured the percentage of individuals that shed their tails by the end of that event. The second thing they did was they approached the lizards with a cat decoy in order to see how the animals responded to this simulated predation event. So the lizards were placed in clear arenas that had brick shelters where they could hide, and then the people who were performing the experiment could push the decoy along in such a way that only the decoy was seen and they couldn't be seen manipulating it. So this allowed them to watch what the lizards did when the decoy approached. So were the lizards fleeing? Were they approaching it? Were they standing still? What was going on? And then they also looked to see whether it just purely ran away or whether it ran away into the refuge. And then they also measured the distance to the decoy at which the lizard initiated its escape, so the flight initiation distance. And I will take a quick break now to play you a song, and then afterwards I'll tell you what they found. Welcome back to The Wild Side. This is your host, Caitlin Kight, and that was Devendra Banhart with An Island. Now on today's show, I'm talking about two recent scientific papers, and the first of these is a paper looking at the effects of introduced cats on lizard behavior in some Greek islands. So just before the break, I was talking about the methods that were used to study these two different species and their interactions, and now I want to talk about the results of the study. So first of all, what were the results of the cat surveys? Well, completely unsurprisingly, the researchers found that there were more cats near human settlements, so within 300 meters of people. And on average, they found about 16 cats per square kilometer. So that's actually quite a lot of predators, if you're thinking about it from the lizard's point of view. Now, they also looked at sites that were further from human settlements, so at least 500 meters, and also islets that were just off the coast of this island. And they found that these were definitely low cat density sites, to the point where they actually saw no cats at all while they were doing their surveys. Now, they acknowledged that cats do have quite large ranges, so it's possible that these animals do encounter lizards because they wander through every now and then, but they did perform three different surveys in each of those low density sites, and they never saw a single cat. So basically, most of the lizards in those areas are, you know, virgin to the presence of cats. Now, the two types of sites were, in all other specs, more or less similar. So they had very similar types of habitat characteristics, which suggests that any behavioral differences that they see in the lizards are more likely related to the presence or absence of cats rather than the kind of vegetation and structure of the habitat. Now they also performed lizard surveys, and they found that there were significantly different numbers of lizards that were found in the cat areas versus the no cat areas. So at the low cat density sites, there were approximately 10 individuals per 100 meter of wall, but there was about half of this at the high cat density sites. Now, maybe this is because the lizards were hiding when they went to do their surveys, because those lizards were much more cautious, or maybe it's because the cats have simply preyed on them so heavily that there are just fewer lizards around. They did do a statistical analysis that looked at the relationship between lizard density and cat density, and they did find a very strong negative correlation that does help support the possibility that cats could be actively depleting the lizard population, or in some other way are responsible for this very large difference in the number of lizards. Now, as I said, they also performed an experiment in the laboratory where they looked at autotomy rates. So they were looking at how quickly the lizards shed their own tails whenever they were held in place, and kind of mimicking the way they would be held in place if a predator had captured them. And they found that lizards from populations that were exposed to more cats shed their tails much more easily during the trial. So there was a much larger proportion of individuals from those high cat population sites that chose to shed their tails. But what about their flight initiation distances? Well, lizards from the high cat density sites generally tended to stay closer to refuges, so they were more cautious, and they also had greater flight initiation distances than lizards from low cat density sites. Now remember, the FID indicates how far away something is or how close you let it approach before you decide to run away. So if you have quite a large FID, that means you're being much more cautious because you don't want it to get close to you. You want to take off immediately as soon as you see it. If you have a small FID, that means you're being a bit more lax about things. You're not feeling as worried maybe that something is going to attack you. So basically these results are indicating that lizards that tend to be exposed to cats on a regular basis are much more suspicious of any sort of potential predator than lizards that are in low cat density sites. And this was actually particularly true for the lizards from the islets. And those lizards have been isolated from cats for a bit longer than the lizards that are in the kind of low cat density sites on Naxos Island itself. And so they do tend to show stronger less strong, I guess, suspicion against potential predators. Now, when lizards were further from a refuge, they fled sooner from an approaching threat, as you might imagine, because regardless of what your experience with cats is, you are going to probably be a bit more cautious if you don't have anything nearby to run to. However, this was particularly true in areas that had high cat densities. So the cats were kind of a confounding factor that magnified almost this particular behavior. And these are the places where it's most dangerous. There are lots of cats and you're out in the open far away from where you need to go to hide. Now the cat predation experiment was potentially the most interesting part of the whole study. So this is where they had the lizards in the laboratory and they were exposing them to a cat decoy. What they found was that lizards from sites with more cats fled at greater distances during the standardized presentation of that cat decoy. And this could be seen even in the difference between the first, second, and third iterations of each trial within the experiment. So basically, individual lizards were showing variations in behavior over time, because as soon as they had one exposure to a cat, they then reacted more strongly the second time, and then again the third time as well. So they were learning, basically, as they went, to be a bit more cautious and to respond to that decoy. 60% of lizards from the islet populations didn't seek refuge at all, whereas 22% of lizards from high cat density sites sought refuge. So basically this is showing you, didn't seek refuge. So basically this is showing you that the animals that are less likely to encounter cats become a bit more relaxed, and so they're more likely to be kind of blasé whenever there's a decoy presented. But this behavior was much less common in animals that did see cats a lot, suggesting that they knew exactly what it was that they were being exposed to, and they were responding accordingly. Now, strangely, 20% of lizards from low cat density sites sought no refuge at all, and this was quite similar to the number that was observed at high cat density sites. So it's kind of weird that these two different types of lizard would have very similar behavior, and the authors aren't exactly sure what was going on there. Now, many lizards first moved towards the decoy before running away, which is kind of an odd thing, because you don't really think that's the smartest thing to do when you're being presented with something that's potentially a predator. And this was seen in 76% of islet lizards, 64% of low cat density lizards, and 35% of high cat density lizards. And the behavior was much more common in lizards from low cat density sites than those from high cat density sites overall. So you're kind of combining the islet and low cat density lizards versus the high cat density ones. And I'll talk a little bit more later about why it might be that they tend to show this very strange reaction. Now, the lizards on the one island that had been separated most recently from the main island, so the one that had kind of broken off about 5 years ago, these were very different from some of their neighbors. So they had significantly longer flight initiation distances than lizards from the other islets. So they were more similar to kind of the mainland lizards than to the little islet lizards. But they also had similar autotomy rates. So they had 25% tail loss, which was about the same amount of tail loss from the islets, but much lower than the tail loss that they saw from Naxos. So basically, to put those two things together, they were similar to the main island in one way, but dissimilar to another. And they were similar to the other islets in one way, but dissimilar in another. So there wasn't like kind of a clear pattern where they were like the isolated areas or where they were like the more populated areas. They were kind of stuck in between those two different ends of the spectrum. And again, I'll talk about that a little bit more as I go through the author's discussion. So just to summarize what they found, Basically, the variations in both cat and lizard density suggest that the lizard numbers are low near the villages because the cats are living there and preying on the reptiles. But, as I mentioned earlier, the cats are known to roam quite widely, so it's possible that they do have impacts in areas that are a bit farther from villages, and so they have an even larger impact on the lizard population than what was actually reported here. Now, where the cats were more common, lizards had different anti-predator behaviors. They retreated more rapidly from a potential threat, and they also shed their tails more easily. So even though it can be costly to do these anti-predator behaviors, it's a safer strategy for the lizards than foregoing them altogether and potentially being killed. So they kind of err on the side of caution, expend the energy at the moment just in case it saves their lives for later, and then they kind of deal with that later on. Now, the laboratory experiments suggest that the lizards do have behavioral plasticity. So not only was there variation from site to site, so the low cat density versus high cat density areas, but there was also variation over the short term, so from one trial to another. In the islet group, the flight initiation distances more than doubled between the first and final trial, which indicates that the animals were very quickly responding to the introduction of the predators, even in places where they had been without predators for 6,000 years. So they may not necessarily instinctually have certain responses right away, but they do learn very quickly that something is potentially dangerous and they should react to it in some way. Lizards from the low cat density sites acted more like lizards from islets, even though those two types of animals lived quite distantly. So, also despite this, all the lizards that they looked at displayed similar levels of plasticity from one trial to the next, kind of altering their behavior as they learn. And that suggests that even if the exact behaviors are not necessarily going to be consistent from the very beginning, at least the ability to show plasticity in behaviors is something that might be an ancestral trait and is retained across all of the animals in the population. Now, to see if this is a general pattern across all animals and not just across this particular species of lizard, the researchers suggest that we should study additional introductions. So, for example, how do wallabies across Australia react to the presence of dingoes, which weren't always there? So we could look at other cases like that and see how more or less isolated animals respond, and whether those are similar patterns or whether they're quite different patterns. The islet lizards had several notably different features suggesting that they had evolved quite independently since being separated from Naxos, the main island. A large proportion of the lizards didn't seek a refuge at all during at least one of the predation events, so they did kind of retreat from the decoy, but they didn't necessarily think that it was scary enough to merit going inside and getting themselves out of harm's way. An even larger proportion actually approached the decoy before fleeing, and that, as I said earlier, was quite surprising, but what the authors think is that basically these guys are showing neophilia, and neophilia is kind of an attraction towards new things. And this is something that is quite useful for finding new food resources. So if these lizards, I'm not actually sure how they got to the little islands, but if they find something, found themselves in a new habitat, potentially because they washed ashore or because the island, the little island itself, you know, maybe they always lived there, but it kind of broke off and then the habitat started to change because it was isolated from the mainland. You know, whatever happened, there might be some condition where living on that island makes it better for you to be neophilic, because it means that you are more likely to find sources of food that might just be fleeting or might be new, and you maybe haven't experienced them in the past, even if that's not you as an individual, but you as a species. So showing that behavior on islands could actually be quite beneficial, whereas it might not necessarily be beneficial on land. Or it could also simply be the case that neophilia is more dangerous on the island, where it's closer to humans and other potential predators, but it's less dangerous on the island, and so it simply happens to be a feature that's maintained. But whatever the case might be, it definitely is something that could be driving the lizards to go forward towards the decoy, as opposed to immediately running away. And the low autotomy rates was also a notable characteristic of these guys, so they were much less likely to lose their tails whenever they were exposed to that kind of fake predation event. And this is probably another behavior that was altered because they no longer needed it when they were on the islands. Now, autotomy, as I mentioned earlier, can be a costly thing because the tail is quite a useful feature, and it's quite costly to have to grow it back on again after you've dropped it. So it would be better for these lizards to simply no longer engage in that behavior as soon as they're pinned down by a predator. And so maybe that's something, whether it's an ability that they lost or simply a behavioral response that they lost, it would actually benefit them to not show that behavior if they don't ever need to. So they tended to do it quite a bit less often than animals from the mainland. So the take-home message here is that the research shows that predation can really be a strong selection pressure. You've got cats that are clearly affecting lizards living near where the cats are found, but are having no effect on animals that see cats never or only very rarely. So it seems to purely be the cats that are having this impact on the lizard behavior, whether it's how far they run away, whether or not they approach something that looks like a predator, and how quickly they drop their tail. The pressure can actually act very quickly, so we already were seeing a difference between the islands, the little islets, and also the one that had most recently been broken off from the mainland. So just over a period of 5 years, there was starting to be a variation from the main island to that one, which presumably would eventually kind of end up being like the other little islets that are also isolated off the coast of Naxos. And the adaptability and plasticity that are shown in these situations could actually be very useful. If you think about them from a conservation perspective, you know, if we do have other animals that are being exposed to potential predators because of these artificial introductions, actually it could be quite a good thing if we have some at-risk species that are showing a lot of plasticity. They are learning, or they're simply evolving quite quickly and are therefore able to stand up in the face of these pressures. But we need to see whether this sort of response is widespread in other species or not before we kind of celebrate and say, you know, these invasions aren't necessarily going to be bad at all, let's not worry about them. So one thing we could do is look at whether there are certain characteristics of lizards that are found in other species that are exposed to introduced predators, and see whether some of those characteristics might also confer a beneficial effect. So, for example, is it body size? Is it lifespan? Is it social structure? Is it type of habitat? Is there something that we can use to predict which types of species are going to have this flexibility and maybe be let off the hook when they encounter these sorts of experiences in the wild? Welcome back to The Wild Side. This is your host, Caitlin Kight, and that was Chris Isaac with I'm Gonna Sit Right Down and Cry. And on today's show, I'm talking about two recent scientific papers that I happen to find interesting. They're both about animal behavior. And the first one was about cat predation and lizards, and now I'm going to switch gears completely and talk about egg attendance behavior in wild birds. And this is a paper that is predominantly about the development of a new technology, but it also has some really interesting reports of what it is that birds do when they're incubating in the nest. So I'll talk a little bit about both the technology itself and the behaviors that it revealed. So first of all, I'll start, as always, with a bit of background. We know that most bird species have very different incubation behaviors relative to those of their ancestors, and that's one of the things that makes them quite interesting. So ancestral birds would have buried their eggs. These are things that are much more like reptiles. And this means that they wouldn't have had the kind of physical contact that birds have with their clutches today. And the effect of this introduced kind of physical interaction meant that there was a shorter incubation period, there was accelerated embryonic development, and there was greater control over the incubation conditions by the adults. So because the parents were able to interact with their eggs, they're able to turn them and kind of monitor them and make sure that they are interacting with the environment in the best way. And this seems to enhance the embryonic use of albumin, so the stuff that the embryos are sucking up as they are growing. And this assists chick development and also improves hatching success. So that's why all of these behaviors and characteristics would have evolved over time. It's improving the fitness of these animals. So the adults can influence the egg temperature by flipping the eggs and making sure that all parts of the eggs are getting kind of even, if that's desired, exposure to the warmth from the adults and also from the sunshine, because every now and then the adults are going to be off the nest, and so the eggs will be exposed to the sun as well. And this is going to influence the development of of the animals. Also, it can influence the hatching success, as I mentioned earlier, and it can influence phenotype. So the different sexes are often a response to the ambient conditions. Now, we know this happens in crocodiles, and to some extent this can happen in birds as well. So by adjusting the situation of the egg, they can influence whether they have more males or more females, potentially. Egg incubation behaviors in general are actually really well known in domestic poultry because we have these animals right in front of us and we're able to study them very well. And as a result, farmers are able to use what we know in order to produce the highest number of eggs possible. However, we don't know a whole lot about these sorts of behaviors in wild birds because it's been logistically very difficult to study them. So over time, researchers have used a variety of techniques. So for example, just sitting and watching, marking the eggs, videotaping the nests, and also implanting decoy eggs that have sensors embedded within them. And the last of these obviously sounds kind of the most promising because it has this technological advantage of being able to watch while we're not, you know, from a position that we're not able to achieve. And basically while we're asleep, it can keep on ticking overnight and get a lot of data. However, even the last of these things, these embedded sensors, has not previously been used to look at kind of real-time changes in three-dimensional orientation, which is really what you want to get some understanding of if you're thinking about what the adults are actually doing to the eggs. So the three different dimensions are roll, which if you think about kind of an oblong egg having an axis down the long portion, it would be the roll is rolling it along that length axis. Pitch is if you take the axis and move it to the short half of the egg, and so you'd be rolling around the short bit instead. And then yaw is rotating it around the edge. So if you put a finger on each end of the egg and then, you know, just kind of twist your wrist and you're rolling it in that direction. So roll, pitch, and yaw. So nothing has really been able to look at all three of these things at once or measure the angle changes during the rotation events. So as a result, we've been lacking full characterization of this egg turning behavior in birds. And this means that we haven't really been able to figure out too much about, you know, what are the birds doing and how does that influence their success in producing offspring. Now, the development of modern microtechnologies, such as the ones that we use in our phones, can actually be really useful in this context. And that is what the researchers were taking advantage of in this particular study. They created egg loggers that can record accurate three-dimensional orientation by combining both three-axis accelerometers and also magnetometers, as well as gauging temperature. And these things, the accelerometers and the magnetometers, are pretty much exactly the same ones that you might find in your phone that help you use the compass, identify stars if you've got a night sky app, play games, all sorts of things. So we kind of take them for granted in our own devices, but now they're being deployed by scientists as well in order to more accurately collect data. So they deployed these things in the wild in nests of three different species: Cassin's auklets, western gulls, and the Laysan albatross. And these guys vary widely in terms of body mass, egg mass, clutch sizes, ecosystem, nesting habitat type, parental egg care, all sorts of things. So they were kind of just, this is the very first time they've used these, and they wanted to get an idea of what sorts of things they're capable of. So they really just chose three very different species to see how much variation they could record and whether it was a useful thing for different types of animal. So this variety was allowing the researchers to really get an idea of the functionality of this new equipment and also test some basic hypotheses about parental behaviors. So very briefly, just a few methods. For the auklet nest, the birds only have one egg. So the researchers had to take the real egg and incubate it while they were deploying the artificial logger. So they just kind of swapped them out underneath the auklets. For the albatross eggs, they candled prior to deployment. So basically, candling, if you don't know, is when you pick up an egg and you hold it in front of a light and you look at whether the yolk is actually, you know, whether there's an embryo in there or whether it's just an unfertilized or, for whatever reason, not growing egg. And if they had one that wasn't fertile, then they could replace it with one of the decoys. And they took the other one out and used it to sample for contaminants. So they, you know, albatrosses aren't necessarily doing all that well, so they didn't want to risk the health of the nest. So they only deployed the loggers whenever they were able to replace them with or swap them out for an infertile egg. And all of the eggs were left in place for 2 to 12 days during the breeding season 2 summers ago. So what did they find? Well, they were able to deploy 71 artificial eggs across 35 auklet nests, 17 gull nests, and 19 albatross nests. And all the birds initially accepted the artificial eggs, which is good, but the auklets were a bit more sensitive, and so within 1 to 3 days, about 12 of them abandoned their nests and then tried again later. So luckily, they have been able to use that data to, since then, develop some better eggs that are a bit more believable, a bit less obvious, and they have had much better success in more recent attempts to deploy the eggs. So now they know that what they need to do in order to get all these birds to accept the eggs as their own. Now, in terms of the egg turning behaviors, they found that one of the advantages to the new device was that they could use both the magnetometers and the accelerometers simultaneously to detect the egg turning. And they actually did a bit of a comparison here where they used one alone or both. And they found that whenever they used the magnetometer measurements in conjunction with the accelerometers, they found 10 to 30% higher turning rates. And this was about 10 to 20 additional turns of the egg per day. And this is a huge improvement over previous devices. So clearly these new devices are much more sensitive to the actual bird behavior because they're able to record more than what was previously seen. The median hourly turning rates vary quite a lot. Well, I mean, the number doesn't sound huge, but when you're thinking about all the different nests that they look at, it varied from 1.8 to 2.2 turns per hour. And if you add that up across the day, that is quite a lot of variation in terms of how many times the adults are actually interacting with these eggs each day. And although there were differences between the species, the only really significant one was between the auklets and the gulls. And that's because the auklets were turning much less during the day and much more during night, whereas the gulls were doing it, they were predominantly focusing their behaviors on the daytime. And the auklets do tend to be much more active at night because they have the parents switching over, so that seems to drive this difference. There's also a variation in clutch size, so auklets only have the single egg, but gulls have 1 to 3, and there's a difference in nesting habitat. So there could be lots of things here that are kind of influencing how much the adults are playing around with the eggs. One of the things that they noted was that the absolute differences between albatrosses, auklets, and gulls weren't hugely different, which suggests that maybe there could be kind of some conserved behavior where birds simply evolve to do a certain number of turns per unit of time, and there isn't a whole lot of deviation from that. And obviously they would need to have a bigger sample across the different species in order to see whether that is actually the case. They also suggested that there could be differences from one season to the next, so depending on what the weather is like, the animals might behave very differently. And for both of these things, they say that this new device should be really useful for exploring that in more detail. Another thing that previous studies haven't really been able to provide much information on is the way in which the eggs are rotated. So they knew that the eggs were being moved, but not whether, not the axis along which they were moving. So they had this kind of idea that because eggs were oblong, it was most likely that they would be rolled along the roll axis, so along their length. And in fact, the largest angular changes were not found in roll, but actually in the yaw angle. And this is potentially because the birds are changing the pitch angle and therefore rotating the egg in such a way that prevents it from slipping. So they're kind of balancing it against the rim of the nest, basically, and they're kind of moving their own bodies because they're sitting on the eggs as they're moving them in some cases. They're not nudging them with their bills. And so it might just be the fact that they're kind of shuffling around on the nest a little bit and therefore not doing what would be easiest if you were to take a stick and kind of poke at an egg, which would effectively be like moving it with your bill, you would kind of end up rolling it along the long axis. But if you're sitting down on it and kind of just antsying around like these animals would be doing while incubating, it's more likely that it's going to be kind of rotated around the edge or even along the short axis instead every now and then if it's kind of bumping up against the side. So this is quite a different pattern than what they were expecting. And again, this suggests that, this technology is quite powerful because it's allowing them to see things they would never ordinarily have seen. This allowed them to make some of the first observations of incubation activities at nighttime as well as in the daytime, because as I said earlier, they were relying on some technologies that really had a lot to do with vision. So they would sit and watch, or they would collect video, and, you know, humans can only get so much information at nighttime, even with nighttime cameras, because you can't really see all that well. The quality is not great. But here they've got these sensors in the nest that are able to collect these data 24/7. And what they found was, as I mentioned earlier, the auklets were shifting over from one parent to another at night, so they were quite a lot more active, and that's when you can also see more egg-turning behavior happening with them than in the other two species. And in general, the other two species, the gulls and the albatrosses, were noticeably calmer throughout the nighttime. Between the day and the night, they found that egg temperatures were varying by as much as 2.4 degrees Celsius. Now, for gulls only, there were greater variations during the day than at night, and that potentially has to do with the fact that they have different clutch sizes, there's different level of colony activity, they have differences in how they change over nest duties between the mother and the father, but all of that would need to be looked at in more detail in another study. They also, interestingly, found that only albatrosses had a temperature cycling pattern that was associated with what was seen in ambient temperatures. Now, you'd expect that the day would kind of start off cool, it would get a bit warmer, and then it would drop again at the end of the day, and you would see this kind of up and down cycling throughout the whole study period. And that is what they tended to find in both the auklets and the gulls, that is not what they found in the auklets and the gulls, but that is what they found in the albatrosses. And they don't really say whether that's a function of the fact that the albatrosses are off the nest more, and so the eggs are just kind of following what's happening in the air, or whether they, maybe the albatrosses themselves kind of regulate their heat more in tune with the environment, whereas the auklets and the gulls don't. Maybe the auklets and the gulls are able to kind of nestle in a bit better because of the size of the birds or the construction of the nest. Who knows what's going on? But that, again, is something else that they can begin to investigate now that they know that this is a thing that's actually happening. What they did find that was kind of intriguing was that there was no discernible relationship between egg temperature and egg turning in any of the three species. And this was actually one of the big things that they expected to actively find, was, you know, one of the kind of tenets of incubation behavior is that the birds are adjusting their incubation in order to influence the temperature of the egg, and that they're also rolling the egg around in order to kind of get this even temperature. And in fact, that doesn't seem to be what was found here. And so that could just kind of be an accident. Maybe they need a larger sample size, or maybe the birds don't necessarily need to do that quite as much as we thought they did. Maybe the egg turning behavior has to do with something else rather than a kind of evenness of temperature. Overall, the authors were able to conclude that the new loggers were a big success, especially now that they have modified the design a bit to make them a bit more accessible and acceptable to all of the species. And they hope that they can facilitate a wealth of new studies that allow researchers to look at how hatching rates are ultimately associated with lots of different characteristics of the birds and their habitat. So, for example, the age and experience of the parents, latitudinal variations in habitats, so whether something's up in the Arctic or down near the equator, variations in nest construction, changes across the incubation period, variations that occur because of hormone or contaminant levels, environmental disturbance, whatever is going on in the adults themselves or in the kind of nearby nesting environment in general, they could measure it by using these data loggers. So hopefully these will be quite useful for conservation, for management, for the farming industry, for the pet industry, and also just to get a better idea of understanding how, you know, birds are behaving within the nest and why these behaviors evolved and what the different advantages and disadvantages are of these sorts of behaviors. And that wraps up what I've got for you this week. I should mention that actually as you listen to this, I am currently on a flight heading over to the US. This is a show that's been pre-recorded, and next week's has been pre-recorded as well, but I will be back after that to join you live once again. But for now, I will leave you in the very capable hands of Beck singing Turn Away.